Ladies and gentlemen, tonight I want to welcome you to the Exceptional Conservative Show, live from the nation's capital. We are not ashamed of the good news of conservatism, for it is the power and liberation. First, unto the Republican, and then to the Socialist. Ladies and gentlemen, I wanted everyone to get a head start on tonight, so what I did is, next to the chat room at the Broadcast Central, you'll see a Amazon little webby thingy, or however way, I haven't learned the actual expression, but it is called the War on Cash. The author of that particular book, we've invited to come on our program, and we hope to have him here in good nature soon. But the reason why I wanted everyone to read that particular book, or at least David McCrae's writings regarding money, is that we have a government that has created a fiscal bubble. And there are not too many people on the air that will talk with you about that in relationship to this election. There are many people that are hoping that we don't speak to you about fiat money in America and around the world, and how tying the student loan debt to Americans' currency through the taxpayer has created a bigger bubble than the housing bubble that brought Barack Hussein Obama into office. Even bigger than that is the inescapable counterfeiting of money by the Federal Reserve. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to get the book. It's only $2.99. You can order it directly as you're listening to the show. You can come back to the Exceptional Conservative Show, the Broadcast Central area, or the front page and click on and order that book. But you need to be prepared, because in America, as in Europe and around the world, there's a war on cash. Ladies and gentlemen, you know how we start this particular program. We always get our young people to lead us in, well, not always, but at least we have a preference for the young people leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance to the United States of America. Now, my wife, who is watching via live stream and Ustream, Mrs. Biggs, is with us tonight. And through live stream, you can see the big flag in my, a huge flag in my office that you can pledge to. All others might use the symbols that I have in the office, which are flag-like, to do so. Mary, my bouncer, is in the chat room, as she has been almost innumerably more times than I have been in the chat room over the past 6 years. She is my bouncer. If you diss her, you diss me, and you will be dismissed from our program. Forgive the clock ahead of me, above me, or whatever. It's right only twice a day. We're going to fix that tomorrow. I thank you all so much for making me aware of that behind me. But tonight, I want to focus on the one thing that our founding fathers used to break down the cardinal sin of centralized government. It was capitalism. It was the American currency. and how we have moved so far away from the decentralized voluntary efforts of our founding fathers to a debilitating centralized function of fiat printing. Ladies and gentlemen, there is a republic worthy of pledging allegiance to. It is the United States of America. Join us as we pledge allegiance. That's the way we do it, people. Ladies and gentlemen, and also I want to thank the great composer, Kevin MacLeod, for that rendition of Magic Forest that you heard earlier as we began. It was kind of mystical, kind of dark and mysterious, but it set a tone for how we understand money in our society. As a result of us misunderstanding money, and being opposed to its vibrant strength of liberty and freedom, we have allowed the ruling class, ruling elites, to determine for us not only the value of our currency by counterfeit, but as well the simple fact that we are being enslaved by those in the Republican and in the Democrat Party when it comes to monetary policy. A lot of us don't understand exactly why I'm on this particular route today. Listen, I would have preferred talking about some other things. You know, the kind of stuff that would make people tune into my show on a live basis and say, wow, yes, that's the meat and the potatoes of the argument. Oh, down with Hillary Clinton. Down with her having the guy, the father of the Orlando shooter behind her. Oh, look at the email here. I wish I could do that tonight. But last night's show, and the voice of God changed the way I was going to see tonight. Tonight is not about meat and potatoes for the propaganda elitists that would like me to indoctrinate you into thinking that by voting for one man, we can change the world. Terrorists. We need to make that because you're no longer a hostage, you're a prisoner under Obama, and you're no longer a terrorist, you're a shooter. So I do apologize for passing on that mythology. The Orlando terrorist, the father of the Orlando terrorist, was standing behind Hillary Clinton as she delivered her speech earlier today, preparing for, of course, delivery of an economic speech in Detroit, where the Democrats, over 50 years, virtually made it El Segundo or something like that. Last night's show opened a window to heaven to understand why there are so many people who are opposed to a free market system, opposed to money that's tied to something of value that can neither be destroyed or created by the hands of men. We were talking last night about buying a car. We were talking about the fact that we have moved from a saving economy into a consumer economy in the early 19th century, and virtually that consumption economy was built on us buying large products, luxury products. At one time, they were appliances. I mean, refrigerators, launch, you know, that kind of thing. And then as mass production began to really improve, we were looking at cars and boats and things of that particular. But last night, our focus was on buying a car in a consumer economy. And how many people don't understand they're part of the capitalist system. As much as they fight against it, as much as they walk in the streets and urinate and defecate on police cars because they are in a capitalist system, and then they photograph themselves doing that via an iPhone, many people don't understand the power that the founding fathers left us with the U.S. government tying its money to silver and to gold. And how we virtually lost our soul in the 1970s, right? Abortion did that, but when we moved from tying our money to the fiat currency of digitalized debt, we took the power, or we gave the power of our sovereignty over to a government that would blindly tell us the value of our wealth, our money. And what I was discovering last night as I was teaching that class, and of course, the class that people really, or the show that people really listened to in the past month, actually about 2 weeks ago, the big show was Central Bank Secrets. That was the big show. People wanted central bank secrets. But here's a central bank secret that you should be well aware of. The power that you once had in cash has been taken from you by your government, by our government. And if we don't fight to get it back, we could create our own, or have in certain aspects, system of indentured servitude to a ruling few, and an enormous debt that would seem inescapable by human hands. So tonight I really want to focus on the war on personal sovereignty in America. And this war has been on since the founding of this nation. When you're able to be as wealthy as a king and stand before a king and not have to bow, that's equality, man. There are those who don't want you to have that type of power, that type of equality. And I'm sure, I'm quite certain you're probably sitting back, some of you all are sitting back and saying, well, Ken, what you gonna do, talk about buying a car again? No, for some I will help. But for a larger share, you should be tuned in tonight instead of the Olympics. Tonight I want to talk with you about money and how a few are taking control of your financial life. There's a war on cash, and it's not to make you better. Is actually to make us all worse. When we come back from the break, we get into what exactly is money, and we also take a look at why a course of fiat money has been chosen in America. You're listening to the Exceptional Conservative Show live from the nation's capital. We are not ashamed of the good news of conservatism, for it is the power of liberation. First the Republican, and then the Socialist. Mm-hmm.
Hey, it's Jersey Joe. Tilton Reaver, Common Sense. You can catch me every Wednesday night, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on shrmedia.com. It's every Wednesday night, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, shrmedia.com.
In a world controlled by corrupt politicians.
You got a business. That you didn't build that.
A team of ordinary men emerge from the ashes to give voice to the voiceless and hope to the hopeless. Sackhead Sean.
Dude, I'm not saying half of stupid.
Sackhead Clint.
All good friends of ours usually show up drunk.
Also starring Sackhead as the producer.
I'm a little bit drunk, I'm a little bit drunk, cause I'm drinking, drinking, drinking.
They are the Sackheads Radio Show. Every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Pacific on shrmedia.com.
Now, Brownells, we know you may have only one shot to harvest that trophy, so we have thousands of accessories and replacement parts to improve your chances. Then how much you love to shoot, so our gunsmiths' articles and videos will help you do more and get more out of your guns. We also value your hard work and money. That's why only Brownells backs up everything we sell with a 100% unconditional lifetime guarantee. Brownells, the world's largest supplier of firearm accessories and gunsmithing tools. From coast to coast, there is one bank focused on building a better future. One bank with programs you can trust to help boost your economic picture. One United Bank. With rates better than the national average, no hidden fees, and even cashback debit cards, you will feel the boost in your budget. One United Bank. The premier bank for urban communities in Boston, Miami, and Los Angeles. Visit us at oneunited.com or call 877-ONE-UNITED today. Member FDIC.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want to welcome you back and also want to thank my very good friends at SHR Media, which is Sackhead Sean, Sackhead Clint, and Free Socko. I want to thank them so much for allowing us to broadcast live on their network as well, broadcasting live on High Plains Pundit Media. I want to thank the good old man, Dan the Man Butcher, for bringing us the best conservative news in America. And as well, I want to thank the good people from Red Nation Rising, 2 a.m., who broadcast us on the Liberty Channel on Red Nation Rising. I want to take you to the coinage clause for those who are following along at home as we talk about money today. And that's, we're going to reference the work of the Heritage Foundation in this regard. Congress's power to coin money is exclusive. Article 1, Section 10. The states are not permitted to coin money, emit bills of credit, or make anything but gold and silver coin a tender in payment of debts. Congress has been granted power in an open-ended manner. Article 1, Section 8, Clause 2. The Congress shall have power to coin money, regulate the value thereof, and of foreign coinage. Really to set the trade. They are granted, Congress is granted the authority to coin money and authorize the value of it. But that is a limitation which somehow constitutionally we have allowed our Congress to surpass. The money should have been tied to gold and silver, to precious metals. But in 1972, a certain little guy who said, "I'm not a crook," took us off the gold standard. And I've had great economist on my program, Dr. Brooks Robinson, Dr. Mark Thornton, and so many others who have come on and said that that was probably one of the worst mistakes allowed by American citizens. Why? Because we have allowed our government then to control our commerce, our taxation, and everything else tied to a value they discern in that which is not real. So when we hear people talk about funny money, in a sense, and I'm not, I just want y'all to put this into context. We participate in funny money a whole lot, a great deal, because we have allowed an institution to become the basement bank of our Congress and print money religiously to deal with the economic situations that we have in our country and around the world. And eventually, once your kid has written enough on the wall with Crayola, it comes to a point where the kid will drop the Crayola because they can't go any further. That is one of the greatest fears that we have with fiat currency. When is too much too much? I want to bring to you exactly how we value money, and I want to share Doug Levinson. And trust me, we're going to get into Mr. McRae's writing, and I hope that you get the book. It's right on our front page and also right next to our chat room. You can pick it up. It's only $2.99. But there is a problem with fiat currency, and I want you to know what that is.
If you try to pay for something with a piece of paper, you might run into some trouble. Unless, of course, the piece of paper was a $100 bill. But what is it that makes that bill so much more interesting and valuable than other pieces of paper? After all, there's not much you can do with it. You can't eat it. You can't build things with it. And burning it is actually illegal. So what's the big deal? Of course, you probably know the answer. A $100 bill is printed by the government and designated as official currency, while other pieces of paper are not. But that's just what makes them legal. What makes a $100 bill valuable, on the other hand, is how many or few of them are around. Throughout history, most currency, including the US dollar, was linked to valuable commodities, and the amount of it in circulation depended on a government's gold or silver reserves. But after the US abolished the system in 1971, the dollar became what is known as fiat money, meaning not linked to any external resource, but relying instead solely on government policy to decide how much currency to print. So which branch of our government sets this policy? The executive, the legislative, or the judicial? The surprising answer is none of the above. In fact, monetary policy is set by an independent Federal Reserve System, or the Fed, made up of 12 regional banks in major cities around the country. Its Board of Governors, which is appointed by the President and confirmed by the Senate, reports to Congress, and all of the Fed's profit goes into the U.S. Treasury. But to keep the Fed from being influenced by the day-to-day vicissitudes of politics, it is not under the direct control of any branch of government. So why doesn't the Fed just decide to print infinite $100 bills to make everyone happy and rich? Well, because then the bills wouldn't be worth anything. Think about the purpose of currency, which is to be exchanged for goods and services. If the total amount of currency in circulation increases faster than the total value of goods and services in the economy, then each individual piece will be able to buy a smaller portion of those things than before. This is called inflation. On the other hand, if the money supply remains the same while more goods and services are produced, each dollar's value would increase in a process known as deflation. So which is worse? Too much inflation means that the money in your wallet today will be worth less tomorrow, making you want to spend it right away. So while this would stimulate business, it would also encourage overconsumption or hoarding commodities like food and fuel, raising their prices and leading to consumer shortages and even more inflation. But deflation would make people want to hold on to their money, and a decrease in consumer spending would reduce business profits, leading to more unemployment and a further decrease in spending, causing the economy to keep shrinking. So most economists believe that while too much of either is dangerous, a small, consistent amount of inflation is necessary to encourage economic growth. The Fed uses vast amount of economic data to determine how much currency should be in circulation, including previous rates of inflation, international trends, and the unemployment rate. Like in the story of Goldilocks, they need to get the numbers just right in order to stimulate growth and keep people employed without letting inflation reach disruptive levels. The Fed not only determines how much that paper in your wallet is worth, but also your chances of getting or keeping the job where you earn it.
Many people in our society are quite disillusioned by the fact that our federal government has no control over the money supply. That was not what our founding fathers intended. In fact, they kind of figured that having a political or partisan influence would cause individuals to either overproduce money or underproduce it, thus by their own philosophies creating a system that penalized the wealthy or made harsh lives of the poor. That's why your founding fathers didn't want a political party. What they wanted were clear-thinking people that were proactive rather than reactive to economic pressures and situations around the world. Because they understood that America was founded on four basic core principles. They were Christianity, they were conservatism, they were constitutionalism, and they were capitalism. You see, commerce was the effective tool by which we actually became independent. I mean, foreigners would come to this country in visitation and say, oh, this is the utopia that we've all sought for. How do we turn those natural resources into something profitable and good? America has everything and has everything that many other nations around the world wish they had. How do we make an equal exchange of our wealth for the goods and services of others? Well, our founding fathers had hoped that we would have tied and kept tied to the gold standard, at least, so that we would have something of substance to compare our values to, and not use political arguments, which are normally very far behind economists, which are very far behind the actual needs of the businessmen and the currency experts or the money supply experts. They didn't want us to become a reactive nation. They wanted us to remain a proactive nation. So how do you remain proactive rather than reactive? How do you make things work so that your people are able to profit without governmental intervention, without need of a national bank? Yes, Washington and Hamilton believed in a national bank, but Jefferson and others said, hey, no, we don't need a national bank. We don't need a government telling you what you should buy and sell by a fiat standard. We need the money to be as decentralized and voluntarily used as possible. As local as the money can be, the better off we are. That's what our founding fathers wanted. Unfortunately, many wiser people found that to be quite debilitating. So what they decided was, our money needs to be centralized. We need someone to oversee, to keep us from all hurt, harm, and danger of recessions and depressions. Although by natural standards, depressions were no more than about 4 years, recessions no more than about 2 years. But there's a political problem with recessions and depressions. Government gets blamed for not reacting fast enough. And so when politicians who don't wish to be blamed and want to remain influential and have power and access and want to stay in Washington all the days of their lives, they don't want you back at home out in California and Nebraska and Idaho blaming them for monetary. No. What do we need? We need a nationalized system. Ladies and gentlemen, many Americans don't know what money is. I want to take a moment here, thanks to Shane Killian. I want to express to you exactly what money is. And when we come back after the break, I want to talk with you using Mr. McCree's book as to why the war on cash has taken away your personal sovereignty.
I've had to make quite a few videos getting back to the basics as far as economics is concerned. But one thing that became fairly obvious from the comments was that, sooner or later, I was going to have to make a video talking in very basic terms about what money actually is. I finally realized this had to be done when the Amazing Atheist proffered the myth in a recent video.
Now, the line fed to us by the Ron Pauls and Alex Joneses of the world is that we traded our real wealth, which is gold, for fake wealth, which is paper money. But of course, that doesn't make any sense, because it's all just a matter of human value perception. It's only valuable because human beings perceive it to be valuable, just like paper money is only valuable because human beings perceive it to be valuable.
Nothing could be further from the truth, but to see why, we have to take a look at what money actually is. Without money, you're left to barter. If you have a dairy cow, you can milk your cow and then go and offer the milk as payment for something that you need. If you need a loaf of bread, then you have to ask the baker how much milk he's willing to accept as payment for it. And if the baker doesn't need milk, you have to go find another baker who does. And you have to do it before the milk spoils. In an extreme situation, you might imagine the baker needing his horse shod. The blacksmith doesn't need bread, but needs a new apron. And the tailor doesn't need any spinning done, but, aha, needs milk. So, having put in a lot of legwork to discover all this, you give your milk to the tailor in return for an apron, give it to the blacksmith in return for shoeing the baker's horse, and the baker gives you bread in payment. Whew. There's got to be an easier way. Money is what cuts out all the extra work and headache. If you have a commodity that everyone values, then you can just sell your milk to the tailor and buy the bread from the baker. Everyone else can then work out their own needs separately. In order to properly fill this function, money must have four aspects. It must be a medium of exchange, a unit of account, a store of value, and a standard of deferred payment. The medium of exchange is what we just witnessed in our example. In each case, every player in the market was willing to accept the money in exchange for some good or service. Why would they be willing to do this? It isn't as simple as people just perceiving it to be valuable, as TJ believes. It needs five separate characteristics. The first is that it must be transportable. In our example, the dairy farmer must be able to collect the money from the tailor and deliver it to the baker. The second is it must be divisible. If the price of the bread is lower than what he sold the milk to the tailor for, he needs to be able to divide it down and pay the smaller price to the baker, saving the extra money for something else. It must have a high market value in relation to volume and weight. It must be recognizable as money. In this case, the dairy farmer, the tailor, the blacksmith, and the baker all have to recognize and understand that the money is a valuable medium of exchange. And finally, it must be resistant to counterfeiting. The unit of account is related to the idea of the money being divisible. By having a standard unit, it's easy to tell how much you have. By being divisible, it can be broken down into smaller units without losing any of its overall value. It must be fungible, meaning that each unit must be perceived as equivalent to any other unit. And it must be verifiably countable. The store of value is incredibly important. Money doesn't create value, but it does let you hang on to it. In this way, it's kind of like a battery. Batteries do not generate electricity, but they help you store it for later use. Not only must it be able to be saved, stored, and retrieved, but it also must be valuable when it is retrieved. Finally, it must be a standard of deferred payment. If the baker is kind enough to give us a loaf of bread, trusting us to pay him for it when our cow is ready to give milk, then in this way we can defer the payment. The money must be considered as the appropriate way to settle our debt with the baker. The money becomes what's known as a tender. When the government establishes a form of money for deferred payments, it's called legal tender. Gold works extremely well for all of these functions. It's universally recognized as valuable, so it makes an excellent medium of exchange. Since every ounce, or gram, or whatever unit of weight you want to use, is the same as every other ounce of gold, assuming, of course, the same level of purity, it's fungible. If divided in two, the 2 half ounces together are worth the same as the full ounce. It's a store of value. In fact, gold holds its value incredibly well over time. And since it is so reliable at holding its value, it makes a good standard for deferred payment. But what about paper money? TJ says it's just the same, because human beings perceive it to be valuable. It's not true, but in order to understand why it's not true, you have to understand something that may sound surprising. There really is no such thing as paper money. Paper is not a medium of exchange. There are different types of paper that have different values. A $100 bill has just as much paper in it as a $1 bill. Paper is not a store of value, nor is it a standard for deferred payment. People don't actually think that there's $100 worth of ink and paper in a $100 bill. They understand instinctively, even if they may not realize it intellectually, that the paper is acting as a proxy for a different kind of value. This is a $20 gold certificate from 1905. If you lived in 1905, or any time up until the United States went off the gold standard, you could take this $20 gold certificate into any bank or assayer's office and receive that amount of actual gold. The $20 would then be taken out of circulation. By the same token, you could take your gold to the bank or assayer and get the appropriate certificates corresponding to the amount of gold you gave up. This would represent new money in circulation. So what about today's money? If paper money is a proxy and we're off the gold standard, what is our money a proxy for? Our monetary system is known as fiat money. In other words, the money is declared to be valuable by government fiat. It has value because the government says so, because the government says so. This mandates its use as a standard of deferred payment. If a debt is owed, the person to whom the debt is owed must, by law, accept U.S. dollars as payment for the debt. That's the concept of legal tender. What has been absolutely destroyed is its store of value. If you have $10 in your pocket, it is not worth the same as that very same $10 bill would have been last year. The reason why is that the government, or more accurately the Federal Reserve, has complete power to print up however much money it wants, and it doesn't take much to run a printing press. With the gold standard, the way in which new money enters the system is with people mining and extracting gold. This takes up resources, far more resources than simply switching on a printing press. For example, you have to pay the miners for their labor. So with the gold standard, the new money represents actual tangible value. The value of the workers who mine the gold, the value the investors put into it, the capital used to make it all happen, and so on. With fiat currency, it's all just ink and paper. The new money does not represent any significant amount of resources being used to initially obtain it. Initially, newly created fiat money causes an expansion of the economy. The new money appears to be additional sales and investments, which encourage businesses to step up production. But that's not what's happening. In reality, since the mere act of printing money does not increase economic wealth, the newly created money represents a portion of the same level of economic wealth as was there before. This means that the value of everyone else's money goes down. The economic expansion is an illusion, and the price is soon paid. In the United
States... I want to stop there for a moment. And I want you all to recognize what Shane Killian has said in comparison to what was mentioned earlier by Doug Levison. That the devaluation of money creates, in a sense, a depreciation of the value of the economy, which in turn does not stimulate an economy. It causes individuals to hold on to their wealth longer. And many people in our economic system right now, when you listen to the stock markets, savants of the given day speak to the stock market, they know that it's being propelled by the perpetual printing of money. These stocks are not going up because of the value of the companies. I mean, their earnings reports are telling you clearly that. But there is no other place to go with the money in the world but to the only game in town, which is the stock market. Because there's constant printing, there is a devaluation of the profits, which when you have fewer profits, there's some things you don't invest in. You don't invest in supplies. We saw this week that there was a revision in terms of industrial productivity downwards. That they're not telling you or promoting today, like having 250,000 people hired last month. Although, when you look at the employment scenario, only 62.8% of those individuals who are eligible to work are in the workforce, which means that over 30% unemployment exists in reality. Why? Because they have gotten out of the employment. And some people say, well, they retired. Being unable to find a job is a quick, discernible way of being retired without money coming in. So literally, we have watched over the past 40 some odd years, just as in Detroit, 50 years of political decision making and determinations crushed the auto industry and every other industry that was basically aligned with the auto industry and turned everyone to depending on government to do something that only private industry could do. You now see Detroit, Flint Hill, and everything else crushed in that area. Printing of money. Well, now we have a very large unemployment rate. We have immigrants who are being encouraged to come in, illegal immigrants, knowing that they're not going to be paid at the same level as someone who would be a citizen and require, based on skill set, the same type of reimbursement of their value. You have individuals who wish to institutionalize an indentured servitude system on the Republican side and on the Democrat side, and they want to continue printing money, suppressing the economy. And then there are those who would tell you that if we vote for one man, that one man will change everything, when we have learned early on that the person or groups that are in charge of money is the Congress. They have the ability to do something that no president can do, but they choose not to do it. We have a social contract through our money, which is built on the rule of law. When Congress allow the President of the United States to circumvent the rule of law, with the money supply based on what precious metal it would be tied to via fiat printing, we turned our economy over from the hands of men to the partisanship of bureaucrats. Bureaucrats that don't want that power to go back to you, no matter who gets elected to the presidency. I just wanted to say that to you all, as Shane speaking, because sometimes we have a habit of listening to stuff and allowing it to blur over us. Your country, your government, is defeating you and me.
States and most other countries with fiat money, which is most other countries, the new money is injected into the banking system. This exacerbates the problem. First, the fractional reserve system multiplies the amount of newly created money, as I explained in a previous video. The new money pushes interest rates lower than where they otherwise would be. Since the interest rate is the price of a loan, loans are now cheaper, and so more people and businesses go into debt. All of this sends fake signals into the economy, resulting in malinvestments and capital being put into areas that would otherwise have been avoided. In the most recent crisis, this was the housing market, as the artificially low interest rates helped to disguise the risks of the loans in the secondary mortgage market. Obviously, this can't go on for long. The economy responds with a credit crunch, known more informally as a bust, and the economy goes into recession. The recession helps to reallocate the monetary assets back to where they need to be for a sustained, efficient economy. Although most political economists claim that this description is incorrect, it is the only model that has successfully predicted every bust since and including the bust of 1920. There is more about this in my video on the Great Depression. It makes sense if you think about it. Since money needs to be a store of value, its value needs to be able to seek equilibrium based on supply and demand, just like every other commodity. Again, the only way new money can be created in a gold standard is to spend the resources to mine new gold. But people are only going to do that if the money they create by mining the gold is worth more than the resources they put into it. So this serves as a protection from money getting too valuable and causing deflation. Conversely, if money starts getting less valuable and threatens to cause inflation, more people are going to trade in their money for gold, taking it out of circulation and thus arresting the inflation. As the value rises again, they may trade their gold back for more money, keeping the system in balance. But with fiat money, there's no consequence for the government printing however much they want. Printing a note, whether it's $1 or $100, costs 3.5 cents. If you could get an instant $100 return on an investment of only 3.5 cents, wouldn't you do it? A lot?
Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, 3.5 cents. For the debt that we have. 3.5 cents, ladies and gentlemen. Now, one of the things that I really push for with my advertising team is that we would encourage individuals to take a look at gold in their portfolios. And I want to thank the good people at Golden Eagle Coins for coming on and sponsoring our program, or at least serving as a advertising tool in our program. In the end, when the fiat policies and as well the money fails, there has to be something that will stand the test of time. Precious metals have always stood the test of time. Why am I uniquely concerned about our situation right now as a country? And listen, tomorrow I will talk with you. It seems like this has been all about economics this week. And I have a tendency to do that when I get on a roll with economics. I love talking about economics and the economy and capitalism and so on. But I am uniquely concerned with where we are financially. as a nation. And where we are financially as a nation can dramatically impact not only how we feel about our nation, but also how we produce. I want you to understand that the total personal debt that's outstanding in America is $17.6 trillion. That's personal debt. Remember last night I talked with you about how much personal debt you should have before you go out and buy a car or whatever, and how you should calculate all that. Right now, personal debt is composed of $13.9 trillion of mortgage debt. Our student loan debt is advancing faster than our mortgage debt, although it's only $1.4 trillion outstanding. Our credit card debt, which used to be our biggest concern in America, has fallen to less than $1 trillion. The personal debt per U.S. citizen is $54,226. Why am I concerned about that? Because the revenue per taxpayer is $28,246. We have a national debt of $19.4 trillion. Fewer people in the workforce, producing less revenue, and being asked to pay for so much more debt, and also to create debt. Debt that's not based on anything that's precious, but everything government says. Has the government ever lied to you? Has a member of the government ever lied to you? If you can put your trust in a bureaucrat, how much risky our national debt is, because we don't understand what personal debt does to us, what money does to us, or has been done to, and how important it is to get our servants, our public servants, to understand that fiat ain't real. Ladies and gentlemen, buying a car, it's a part of the capitalist system. Creating wealth is part of the capitalistic system. Money is a contract which sets the exchange rate by which we manage the value of goods and services versus what we offer in terms of a legal tender or debt. Yet there's something wrong with the people that believe voting in one man is going to change our system, which has been stacked against us. The real system that's rigged is not just our electoral system. It's our money system. We've been rigged. The unfortunate thing is that ticking that you hear behind you is not my clock, because that's not working. It's the debt clock that keeps ticking and taking away your freedom and your liberty. When we come back in the fourth quarter of our program, we're going to finish off talking about the war on personal sovereignty, and our focus will be on Mr. McRae's book. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a republic as long as you can keep your cash. We'll be back right after these breaks. Thank you for listening to the Exceptional Conservative Show, live from the nation's capital.
Now, Brownells, we know you may have only one shot to harvest that trophy, so we have thousands of accessories and replacement parts to improve your chances. We know how much you love to shoot, so our gunsmiths' articles and videos will help you do more and get more out of your guns. We also value your hard work and money. That's why only Brownells backs up everything we sell with a 100% unconditional lifetime guarantee. Brownells, the world's largest supplier of firearm accessories and gunsmithing tools.
My name is Christopher Arnold. I'm an executive chef of a Fuse restaurant, and today I'm going to walk you through some of the meals that we prepare here. So we're making a pizza. We're using fresh Italian sausage that we cook here and slice it up. Pizza dough is in-house made. Pizza sauce is in-house made. So everything is fresh and green. This is our Thai curry chicken. The sauce is made with coconut milk and the Thai red curry. It is juicy chicken thighs as well as some mixed vegetables. Served with jasmine rice and pita bread. We're going to prepare our famous blackened tilapia and grits, our fish and grits on the menu. Our fish and grits, and our meal will be complete. Let me tell you about our infused pea burger. So we kick the spice up just a little bit with our infused sauce. We start off with 80-20 USDA ground chuck, ham patty burgers, like half a pound of burgers, and we're going to grill it to perfection. After I flip the burgers, we add the sauce and let it cook on into the meat just a little bit. Pepper jack cheese to this burger, spice it up a bit.
Ladies and gentlemen, Infuse Restaurant, 6339 Allentown Road, Temple Hills, Maryland. Home of the exceptional wine. Yes, I'm going to try to get there sometime this weekend and taste my official burger, the exceptional wine. Double bacon, double burger. Ah, loving up on it. Also, they got vegan stuff there that my wife likes, you know, but their food, their brunch is to kill for. 6339 Allentown Road, Temple Hills, Maryland. Make your way out there to Infuse Restaurant. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the most influential conservative talk show in the world. It is the Exceptional Conservative Show, live from the nation's capital. We are not ashamed of the good news of conservatism, for it is the power of liberation, first to the Republican and then the Socialist. I also want to thank Mrs. Biggs, smooches. She's in the chat, well, not chat, but she's watching via live stream and Ustream, monitoring my productivity and making certain that I am efficient in my skill set. Also, in the chat role at Broadcast Central at the Exceptional Conservative Show is none other than the beautiful, the brilliant Mary Brockman, who is my bouncer. If you diss her, you diss me, and whoop, you are dismissed. So glad to have you all here, and I am so glad. Did I listen to the Jesse Jackson speech today? No, I don't listen to Jesse Jackson, not unless he's going to identify the new babies he's produced. Otherwise, I am so looking forward to Jesse Jackson showing up on the Maury Povich show. who's that, your baby? That not my baby. Ah, my baby gotta have hope. There's no hope in that dope. That's not my baby. No, I don't watch Jesse Jackson. I tell you, what an idiot. But, ladies and gentlemen, you know what time it is. At this time of the evening, on Tuesday evenings, we talk with none other than the vivacious and charming young lady from Washington, D.C. She's in the 495 corridor. Janice Hall, the J. Hall World Report. We bring it to you live. And there is so much that we need to talk about tonight. I don't even believe that we're going to be able to get to the Olympics. And you all know how much she loves the Olympics, right? Just really love the Olympics. One ringy dingy, there we go. Two ringy dingy. Thank you. Yes, DNA testing. With Jesse Jackson. Janice Hall, J. Hall World Report.
Hello, you have reached Janice. Please leave a message.
Okay, we missed Janice on that line. Let us try one other line for Janice Hall. Okay. And there is so much going on in this particular world. And I do mean so much. I don't want to miss out on her this week.
Blog Talk Radio.
Okay. That's not her. Okay. Let us try this one other time here. Okay. Wow. Okay. You can go. Let's try this one. One ringy dingy, two ringy dingies. Three ringy dingies. Okay. I think we missed Janice. Something may have come up. We pray for Janice. God bless your soul. We pray that everything's okay. But we're not getting through to her tonight. We had a lot that we were going to talk about. And I may have to slip her in on tomorrow night to go over all of that. Now, I want to say this. Last night we had the Blowhaven Zeppelin on the air. And he makes the assertion that his voice sounded like he was in a tin can. And I do apologize, to the Blowhaven Zeppelin, for the primitive technology that I have. I am not at the skill set level of my great friend, Sackhead Sean, Sackhead Clint. I hope someday to get there. Once you're in a studio, things are greatly different. But something we will work steadfastly on improving our system. Man, I have zero excitement about these things. The Olympics, I have very little excitement about. I have very little excitement. But I do want to talk about a foreign policy thing. And I'm quite certain that when we talk with Janice, hopefully we'll work it out tomorrow. If not, we'll get to it next week. But there is something happening in Russia. Now, you all know that former Russian Prime Minister, now President of the Russian Federation, Vladimir Putin is working extremely hard to build relationships with Recep Erdogan of Turkey, who is the president of Turkey. He's also trying to woo Turkey out of NATO. which could only happen under the Obama administration. Only under the Obama administration could such a thing happen. A great travesty is that. But also, you might well notice that Recep Erdogan, who in months past has threatened Europe by saying that if he wasn't chosen as the gateway of returning the illegal immigrants, better known as radical Muslims, radical Mohammedans, or actually just Mohammedans because their cult is radical nonetheless, returning them from Greece and Europe back to the Middle East, then he would open up the floodgates and let them all come over. And in order to take any of them back, he would have to get paid. So that worked out in his behalf. You got foreign nations that are sick and tired of, you know, Denmark and other great nations, England, so on, France, people of Germany upset. And so Erdogan met yesterday with Vladimir Putin and wined and dined each other, and they're working on getting their relationship back together. While NATO is losing its relationship with Turkey, because Turkey has gone through a coup under Recep Erdogan. I know it was supposed to be the other way around, but literally, because of the coup attempt, he is institutionalizing totalitarian reforms, Islamic or Mohammedan totalitarian reforms, and Turkey is no longer a secular nation as once seen before, a promising Middle Eastern nation joining NATO. At its cusp, it may be at war with NATO soon. Just saying. Under the Obama watch, of course. Also under the Obama watch, the new Prime Minister of Great Britain, Theresa May, will be meeting very soon with Vladimir Putin, President of the Russian Federation, to repair the relationship between Great Britain and Russia. Now, I want you all to know that energy has a lot to do with that. Since Russia is the gas pipeline to all of Europe, and we really haven't had a president who's really pushed hard for our energy to be used in Europe. Well, she's going to be meeting with them. They're going to schmooze one another. We're going to have a problem because Europe, which is tied diametrically to the energy reserves of Russia, will now also be schmoozed by the cover girl of foreign policy now. Yes, Vladimir Putin. Why am I raising all of this up to you? When during a course of a few weeks, we have learned that the President of the United States paid ransom to Iran to get back four prisoners, better known as hostages, from Iran at $100 million apiece. And he says unto us, that's not a ransom. I told you about it. So it couldn't have been a ransom. Yeah, okay, thank you. Thank you for the heads up, but that's what we call ransom. Well, Vladimir Putin, while he's doing all this schmoozing and whining and dying of European leaders, such that Elizabeth would have been very proud of him, or Peter the Great would have been very, very proud of Vladimir Putin doing this. Building relationship with Turkey in the Middle East, building relationships with Iran, building relationships with Great Britain. He's building relationships with everybody that Obama has pissed off. Why is that important? Because, and I'm so glad that my great people from Ukraine listen to this show. Kiev, Ukraine, God bless you all. we the American people see exactly what's happening with all of the deceptions on both sides of the Atlantic and Pacific going on. We understand that Russia has decided to drive a few of their best vehicles, their military vehicles, into or near the Ukraine. Okay, and I want to put this out there for you. This is not being reported too much. I haven't seen much of it today. Maybe not, depending on who you're talking to, but I have not seen this. And you all know that the great thing about the Janus Hall, J. Hall World Report is that we've always been ahead of the game. This is what you need to be watching this week, because they are moving onto the border of Crimea and the Ukraine. Remember now, President Obama said we had nothing to worry about. Crimea belongs to Russia. Russian Federation, it's a long-standing relationship. They are moving to get their country. It is a sovereign nation, and we are looking into it. And we promise reaction, but the key thing is Russia now has Crimea. So literally, we understand what's going on. Russia, going all the way back to its foundings, okay, are foregoing the concerns and threats of the U.S. When you fly F-14s over military warships, aircraft carrier, and they don't fight back, you pretty much know that you have been granted permission to extend your territory as far as the eye can see. So we are watching what's happening in the Ukraine. Maybe Obama prearranged to leave Europe to Russia today. I'm not surprised, Dave. I would not be surprised. I wouldn't be surprised. Work that out along with $400 million. Hey, wouldn't. Now, according to Newsweek, Ukraine has reported an increase in Russian military activity on the border with annexed Crimea, as activists on the peninsula claim an armored column of Russian military vehicles have been spotted moving north into the region. Now, I know what many of you all are thinking. This is all tin hat stuff. This is just a military exercise. Sure. Ukraine's deputy minister on Crimean affairs, Georgi Tukha, said that the Russian government in Crimea has called for military exercises conducted on along the borderline of demarcation. Isn't that what they said about Crimea? This is just a military exercise. Nothing to see here. Turn your heads. Don't look at the jet. Ukrainian television channel 112 reported, speaking on air on Sunday, Tukha said that in order not to put the civilian population in danger, the border crossings have been frozen. Crimea was annexed by Russia in 2014 from Ukraine. Remember now, that's just 2 years ago. After protests in Kiev and elsewhere resulted in the toppling of the pro-Russian presidency of Viktor Yanukovych, who fled the country, Russian forces proceeded to call a snap vote in Crimea, declaring it a Russian territory, and Russian-backed separatists in eastern Ukraine declared their autonomy. Although the UN does not recognize Russia as the rightful government over Crimea, Russian authorities are in control of the peninsula. The exact location of the footage that was taken appears to be Bundinogo Street, which is in the city of Kerek, and the major crossing point with Russia's mainland. Ukraine is currently observing an uptick in violence in the eastern region held by pro-Russian separatists. Remember, this is the same playbook. The exact same playbook that was used for Crimea. They're using it now in Ukraine. I want y'all to understand something. If you Google mapping this bad boy out, and I know that you are, the Russians, under Vladimir Putin, is making a hard right here. Just bear with me here. He's making friends with Turkey, knowing that he has Georgia under his thumb, Azerbaijan, and Armenia. So and also Syria as a friend. So that's Russia. He has cordoned off the Black Sea on one side. He goes into Crimea and is starting to make a hard right up towards Ukraine. I want you to understand something here. If the eastern part of Ukraine is taken up to the Dnieper River, that leaves the rest of Eastern Europe trembling. Belarus, Latvia, Lithuania, Moldova, Romania, and Bulgaria, as well as Poland and Estonia. Forgive me, the people of Estonia who will be listening via the people in Ukraine. So this gentleman is attempting to institute what Peter the Great, what Elizabeth the First, what every great leader wanted to do with Russia: find the Atlantic Ocean. Now, I know some people are saying, Ken, that's all tin hat stuff. It is not by accident that the countries of Hungary and Serbia have noted, along with Poland and Slovakia, concerns about Russian aggression in Eastern Europe. It is not a surprise that Vladimir Putin is having meetings with Recep Erdogan of Turkey, and not a surprise that he's having a meeting with the United Kingdom. With all of the arrests that's going on in Germany, thanks to the radical Mohammedan invasion, with all of the unsettled economic activity as a result of the recessions of Spain, the terrorism in France, the invasion of Italy and Greece by radical Mohammedans who are searching for a new life, and with the Brexit, not discounting the Netherlands, Belgium, and Denmark, who are having issues with radical Muslims, with all that going on in Europe, and NATO being put on the chopping block by similarly both candidates, in a sense, Hillary Rodham Clinton and Donald Trump. There is unease in Europe that's not being reported here, because the reporters here want us to be Europe. You know, the nice utopic Europe? Nah. Europe is on fire tonight. And as our debt clock quickly hails an arrival to $20 trillion, and our military is debunked or flocked by the president of this United States, we have a serious issue. It is the aggression by Russia, USSR 2.0, you go, man. It is Russia's desire for conquest. Now, whether you are a president that can look into the souls of foreign leaders, or a president that sees Vladimir Putin as a leader. And Vladimir Putin, don't be confused with endorsement versus condemnation. Vladimir Putin is a great leader. While the world is fearful of the final days of Barack Obama, who is willing to pay $400 million in ransom for four hostages, better known as prisoners, by the Islamic Mohammedan radicals, jihadists, Europe is on fire. Who started the creation of this fire? Well, wasn't it the great desire for Obama to see a new nation come of Egypt, a nation that would be free? And then Libya went down, and then all of Northern Africa, Iran becomes strengthened. The caliphate seems to be the welcome sign on all of the holiday Mohammedans. Yeah. Someone planted the dynamite. Another has lit the fuse. Vladimir Putin, if you understand leadership, is coming in to take over whatever is left after the bomb is blown. Now, that will be either the bombs that are blown because of the liberal tendencies of people like Merkel and Cameron to allow people into their nations who have no intention on becoming a part of the nation. Or those like Barack Hussein Obama that want us to become a part of Europe, the same Europe that wanted to pass the Stamp Act and did so successfully to tax us without representation. Ladies and gentlemen, the next vote you make can't just be for a president. You're going to need a conservative Congress that's going to have to be able to stand the test of the Mohammedans and the utopian Europeans, because all of them are beginning to bow and kiss the ring, not of the Pope, but of the Putin. We'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen, with more of the best in Urban Conservative Talk. If you think that I'm wrong about what I'm saying, you can easily come to theexceptionalconservativeshow.com, and at the contact area, you can put your remarks, your thoughts, your opinions, to let me know if I'm off the battlefield and sitting in the tinfoil camp. But I assure you, ladies and gentlemen, Vladimir Putin is not meeting with people just because he likes to eat. We'll be right back. That's what your exceptional one does. We'll be right back with more of the best in Urban Conservative Talk for the non-commercial portion of the Exceptional Conservative Show. Stay tuned.
From day's first light till night's last glimmer, your satisfaction is our responsibility. On the range or in the field of duty, you can rely on Brownell's lifetime guaranteed gun parts, tools, and supplies anytime. Any place. It's how we've done business since 1939. Brownells.
Hi, everybody. It's Kristen. I'm here to review Women's Spirits Made by Dogs. I love these shoes. I am an FM sufferer, so finding shoes that don't make my feet hurt is very tough. These don't make my feet hurt. I've tried Pumas. I've tried Nikes. Nikes are pretty good. Pumas, I can't wear. They hurt my feet too much. I mean, it's to the point to where my feet hurt so bad to where I can't even walk. So I was so happy whenever I was contacted to review the new dogs. I love these dogs. I love these things. My feet don't hurt when I wear them. They got the holes in them to keep my feet cool. They got massaging bumpies inside. Feels like you're walking on little things of foam. I mean, like, it's just awesome. I just love it. The heel is a deep well down in your heel, and it protects, it's a shock absorber. So if you're running in them or jumping in them, like if you're on a chair and you have to jump in them, it absorbs the shock. What else? and then it's a higher thing back here for your heel. So it's like a really high thing that protects your ankle from when you're running, so there's no injuries, that so it doesn't cause injuries. It's Velcro, so it's very easy to tighten your shoe, so whenever you're running, your shoe won't fall off when you're trying to run. I love these shoes, and I hope you guys really appreciate this review, and there will be pictures at the end, like always. But I wish you would guys go check them out. They're only, these women's spirits are $40. There's a whole bunch of other kind of shoes that you can purchase as well. There are children's shoes, toddler shoes, infant shoes, men's shoes, women's shoes. Anything you can think of, they got it. And they're pretty cool. So I hope you guys enjoy, and I will see you next time. Bye.
So what do you think about ebooks? Maybe you've never read an ebook before, but you're considering giving it a try. Or maybe you've been reluctant to try ebooks because you don't want to buy another expensive electronic device. Or maybe you already enjoy ebooks, but you haven't been able to find titles from your favorite Christian authors. Whatever your situation, ChristianBook.com has the solution. Your trusted source for print books for over 30 years now offers ebooks. Our always free CBD reader allows you to read on the devices you already own without spending money on a new device. Thousands of Christian ebooks at ChristianBook.com means you can shop with confidence and choose from the titles you want. Plus, we are adding new titles all the time. Browse our huge selection of low-priced Christian ebooks the same way you would printed books, only now you can go from shopping to reading in seconds. Simply select the ebook you wish to purchase, confirm your account information, and start reading. Free samples of every ebook are available, so you can preview the book first, before you buy it. Plus, there's no lengthy app downloads and updates. Accessing the CBD Reader is as easy as going to cbdreader.christianbook.com and bookmarking the page. The CBD Reader holds your ebooks and bookmarks for you, no matter what device you're on. So, you can take your entire ebook library wherever you go and pick up right where you left off. Our customizable options make it possible to read your ebooks in different font sizes and styles. Want a large print version? You've got it in seconds with a simple click of the mouse. Already own a dedicated e-reader? Download your ebooks to your computer from your ChristianBook.com account and transfer them to your device. Try ebooks at ChristianBook.com and start reading your favorite books in seconds. Easy, economical, everywhere you want to read. Welcome to ChristianBook.com ebooks.
It's a love story like no other. From God's heart to yours. And for 30 years, it's been at the heart of every book, Bible, CD, gift, and resource from ChristianBook.com. Over 500,000 products, always at the very best value. ChristianBook.com. Everything Christian. Because it's our story, too.
Yeah!
I've been around the world. I've see some pretty faces, there were some beautiful girls. After all I witnessed, one thing still amazes me. Just like a miracle, you have to see to believe. God bless Texas.
God bless Texas. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to welcome you to the non-commercial quarter of the Exceptional Conservative Show live from the nation's capital. We certainly are not ashamed of the good news of conservatism, for it is the power of liberation, first to the Republican and then the Socialist. We're getting news thanks to my good friend Dave Milner, better known as the Unpleasant Blind Guy, and also Agador, that with 60% of the vote in, 80% of the vote going to Speaker of the House, Paul Ryan, and his campaign for representation in Congress. Apparently, Paul Nealon is losing to him, and doesn't look like that's going to change dramatically overnight. So, unfortunately, Paul Ryan will be returning. Paul Ryan will be returning as the Speaker. I don't know if he's going to be Speaker of the House. I know that he'll be returning. It depends on how elections go in other states at this particular time period. But I doubt very seriously if anybody will go up against the guy who does exercises or whatever. There you go. That's just the way it is. I really am looking forward to the Arizona election. I want to see if Kelly Ward, Dr. Kelly Ward, can upset John McCain. I would think on the Senate front that if that doesn't happen, that John McCain is not upset, then virtually what you have is Donald Trump, who is the head of a moderate rebellion, who basically is closer to Bernie Sanders than he will ever be to a conservative like maybe Phil Graham, I don't know, or Ted Cruz. Certainly much more conservative than any of those guys. He may be stuck with a Democrat Congress, Democrat Senate. You know what I'm saying? Who knows? Then will we be happy with what happened to a few good people? I don't know. Is that this evening? What was it, Mary? If he had lost the seat, he couldn't be Speaker. Well, actually, he could still be Speaker. You don't have to be a member of Congress to be Speaker of the House. They just have to nominate a Speaker of the House to follow the rules. So he could be made president if things don't work out in the election. You know what I'm saying? If it goes to a vote in the House, you know. So there are lots of things that could happen. So let's let Hillary win so it'll all be awesome. No. For a lot of Americans, I don't know I just have to say it, and maybe other Americans feel the same way. You're in a damned if you do, damned if you don't situation, a scenario here in America. You really are. Because you have people who know that our monetary system is rigged, our electoral system is rigged. Gosh darn it, a few are ruling from Washington over the many. That they rule above the law. Laws that they create don't apply to them in Washington. They have friends that they refuse to allow prosecution of, like it under Hillary Clinton. And you just feel that it doesn't matter what you do or what you try to do, they're gonna kick your gluteus, that you're gonna lose. And so we're looking at an out of control governance. Now, Ken, they both do suck. It's just degrees of suck. Like, it's either Hillary suck or Monica suck, depending on the ability. If it goes to the House, Clinton will get it. I believe that too, Dave. I believe that too. Then you have people turning to Susan Collins as representative of the Republicans who are not going to vote for Trump. I told a interviewer over the weekend that I really believe it's going to be a landslide one way or the other. We're either going to go whole hog socialist, because that's what the Democrat, there's no Democrat party anymore, there's a socialist party. We're either going to go whole hog socialist and the moderate rebels of the Republican Party will bow down and bend over and ask for petroleum jelly later on, or you're going to go whole hog conservatives in the U.S. House and Senate, and a New York Republican who's a Rockefeller Republican as President of the United States. That's just the way it is. And you're right, Dave. She represents the establishment. Susan Collins represents the establishment. But it looks like the establishment is winning. And I don't think it helped for me. And others may say, well, you know, he had to do it. But why would you endorse John McCain, Paul Ryan, and other establishments if you're outside the establishment? It just sends a signal that maybe we do have to do that kind of thing. Maybe it's something that you got to do once you become the leader. You got to kind of bring the forces together, and then they will get there. But I don't see it. I just don't see it. And I, with all hope of hopes, I am hoping. That we can probably. As a commentator, and I know what others say on their daytime telecast and broadcast. I don't see what they see. And it may be because I wear these. Maybe it's because I wear these. I'm not whole hog on Trump. Now, don't get me wrong. I know I need to go back and talk about money and finish it off, but I just want to say this. I'm not whole hog on Trump yet. I'm not feeling it. First, it's not enough to have a tax plan. which your tax plan shouldn't really move too far away from where you were in the primary. I know you have to make some adjustments, but the top rate of your plan, 25% to 33%. The top rate for Hillary's tax plan is 40%. You're only 7 basis points off of hers. And I know that that's a lot of money for a lot of people, but it would be a lot more if you just went 10, 25, you know, something like that. If you just had 2, 15 and 25. So, I'm concerned about the variation of the tax plan. I believe that we have done a very bad job when it comes to trade. And I believe it'd be huge to have him in office dealing with trade issues. But wouldn't it be better if we just focus on eliminating tariffs and encouraging other countries to move towards a free market? I know that might be a little jostling or whatever. Trade is important. I know why you do it, but you incentivize daycare, or it becomes another construct of private industry that now goes under the federal funding system. Where you're going to subsidize child care in America virtually. Yeah. The federal government will allow you to write off up to $12,000 for child care in your proposal, Donald Trump. And I appreciate that. But wouldn't it just be better, sincerely, wouldn't it be better if we get rid of all of those types of entitlements and kept tax rates very low? And even better, cut spending so that only the essential things get taken care of. Mama, welcome. Glad to have you here. You know, I'm just afraid that when I vote for Hillary, I destroy civilization. But when I vote for Trump, I destroy the nation. You know what I'm saying? That's where I am. Let me just put that out there. Is a vote for Trump destroying, yeah, I'm typing this as I go, the nation, or a vote for Hillary destroying civilization? That's where I am. I'm like, we have a problem in our country. Russia has a 15% income tax rate. Russia. I think its corporate tax is like 25%. Russia. Why not just cut taxes completely, allow the overseas money to come over here from corporations without penalty? The $8 trillion in overseas money that's just sitting, it's $3 trillion, forgive me. $3 trillion in overseas money from profits that corporations have made overseas, allow them to bring that money over here without penalty, without interest, without charges, freely bring it over. They're talking about an infrastructure bank of $1 trillion stimulating the economy. That's government stimulation, which is again printing money, which devaluates and creates unemployment. What if $3 trillion of private profits were brought from overseas and pushed into the American economy. Do you know how many jobs that would create? If $1 trillion of government money would create 500,000 private jobs, $3 trillion would create nearly $2 million of private jobs in our country. We would be able to expand the workforce, thus increasing the number of people in it, lowering unemployment, and at the same time creating a larger revenue base that we can draw from at the rates of 15 or 25%. We could get rid of the corporate tax altogether and watch what happens. You have to worry about companies going over to Switzerland or Mexico or Canada or China. You wouldn't have to worry about that because they wouldn't be paying taxes, which would mean that those monies or fees of taxes would not be passed on to the American citizen, which means basically you can create more jobs. The American can create more money, or at least save more money, pay off more debt. We move much quicker to a nation that's balanced. Two goals tonight for Phelps. There you go, Mama. Good job. Good job. I think he's well above 20 at this point. He's on his way to setting a world record. Ladies and gentlemen, we've been talking about money. And the Founding Fathers wanted you to understand that you having sovereign control of your wealth is the greatest tool, capitalism being the greatest tool to stopping a government from instituting tyranny. Our job is to fight always against a government which seeks to institutionalize tyranny. Your money, when used voluntarily, decentralizes the banking process. It makes you, the person in charge, with greater buying power. I wanted to go to a book, and I hope that you're able to buy it, and we'll talk about it over due season. David McRae wrote the book, The War on Cash, How Governments, Banks, Nonprofits, and Academics are Abolishing Cash. And I want you to understand that cash in your hands allows you to understand the power of the Founding Father. Of the 100% of cash that's created in the world today, 90% of it is traceable. It's in a bank or some other institution has it, it's used in that particular capacity. However, it's that 10% that the world wants. You're able to hide your money. You're able to transport your money wherever you wish to go. But now businesses are reporting on you buying things over $10,000, acting as an agent of government. Banks are beginning to act as agents of government, reporting to you anytime you make a deposit more than $999.99. There are institutions that are out there that literally are watching you as you spend your money. Why are they doing that? Why are they interested in knowing where your money is? Number one is your cash makes you sovereign. Let me give you the definition of what I'm talking about when I say sovereign. Sovereign is someone supreme in power, possessing supreme dominion, like it unto God. Well, better off, a king. That you become the shot caller over your money. Remember now, taxation was a bill sent to your state at one time, and your state would send you a bill which you would pay to the state, and then the state would remunerate that to the federal government. Meaning that the obligation to you was to be good to your state, not to a federal central government planner in Washington, D.C. Because you were sovereign over your money. Now we have put it in such a situation, our money, where we are not the supreme magistrate of our money, not the supreme controller of our money. In fact, the government is becoming the supreme magistrate or king over our money. They want to know where all of it is. Cash is king. Have you ever heard that? Well, cash is just a tool, so it can't be the king. Who uses the tool is the king. Who has authority over the tool is the king. When the federal government was not in the process of digitizing debt, but tying your wealth, your money, to the gold standard, you were the magistrate. Because you got to pick the people who would decide. They were subject to your rule. But now that you have an independent institution called the Federal Reserve that can print money at the drop of a hat at 3.5 cents a blot sheet for $100 bills, they are in control. That's not good for those of us who use money. Now, in the sense of our particular study, there's a point that I wanted to get to here. Let me just go there. There is Patrick Hennington, an investigative reporter with globalresearch.ca, who made this point. And it's in chapter 4 of this particular book. Great book. I hope that you get it. In the chapter, it's Influencers and Agents of Change. He says, it has long been the dream of collectivists and technocratic elites to eliminate the semi-unregulated cash economy and black markets in order to maximize taxation and to fully control markets. Now, I want you to understand, I am very concerned when both Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump use the term fair share. Those are collectivist terms. Those are not terms that are used by individuals that pursue liberty and freedom. So I'm concerned. I'm not ready to put my full faith and confidence in a vote for Donald Trump. Although I certainly will tell you, I would not condemn my civilization and my children's ancestry to the authority of Hillary Rodham Clinton. So let's just take Hillary Rodham Clinton off the table. I'm juggling on the Donald Trump thing right here. But why? If the cashless society is ushered in, they will have near complete control over the lives of individual people. Do you really believe that your government wants to take control of your life? Have you ever heard of Obamacare? Well, today we were introduced to Trump Care. I think we need to explore this matter. The war on personal sovereignty, more specifically over the coming weeks. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to be free. I want you to be wealthy too. But I don't want you to be under government rule. I want your government to be under your rule. Ladies and gentlemen, a friend of mine told me, always be brave. Don't die a coward. I promise you I always will. With that said and that done, I want you to remember one thing. God has blessed America. It's now time for America to bless God. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for tuning in. We'll be back tomorrow night with another episode of the Exceptional Conservative Show, live from the nation's capital. I am your host, the exceptional one, Ken McClinton. Look forward to you coming back. Thank you.